Good afternoon, folks, and welcome back to another session of the Truth Enlightened. Trust that you had a good week and you're having a wonderful weekend. And happy Sabbath to you who keep Sabbath. I thank you all for, tuning in to the Truth Enlightened. All right. Today, I have another good one for you. And I trust that you'll be able to grasp something from these different lessons. All right. I did the introduction to Zephaniah last week, and we are doing the introduction to Zechariah, the book of Zechariah this week. All right, so without any further ado, let's get into it. Last week, our lesson was based upon women in church and the role women supposed to play in church, and we learned that the Bible, in the Bible it's instructed that men should lead, especially in teaching, and no woman should not usurp authority over the man. This week I'll show you the different Bible texts that people use to support women teaching, and then you let me know, if any one of them support that team. All right. Encouragement and hope in the book of Zechariah are the underlying theme of the prophecy of Zechariah. The prophet Zechariah was one of the three prophets, along with Haggai and Malachi, who ministered to the exiles returning to Jerusalem. These exiles faced the ruins of what had once been a splendid city and a glorious temple. There was much to be sad about, but Zechariah encouraged the exiles with vision of judgment on Israel's enemies and of the complete restoration of the city of Jerusalem. Yet the most thrilling vision of all was the prediction of a coming king, the Messiah, who would bring eternal salvation and the promise of eternal kingdom. The name Zechariah means Yahweh remembers. This powerful phrase communicates a message of hope. The God of Israel will mercifully remember his people. The prophet is identified as the son of Barshea, the son of Ido. Ido was among the heads of the priestly families that returned from Babylon in Judah. Zechariah then was a member of the tribe of Levi and probably served as both a priest and a prophet. He entered his prophetic ministry 2 months after his contemporary Haggai had concluded his first oracle. Those who question the unity and single authorship of Zechariah usually argue that chapters 9 through 14 date from the Hellenistic period at 331 to 167 BC, or the Maccabean period in 167 to 73 BC. The reference to Greece in chapter 9:13 has often been cited as evidence for the late date. after Alexander's conquest in 330 BC. However, Greek influence was strong in the ancient Middle East as early as the 7th century BC. Greece is mentioned by the 8th century prophet Isaiah. You can see Isaiah 66:19, where Greece is referred to as Javan. And the 6th century prophet Ezekiel, you can see Ezekiel 27 verses 13 and 19 for Javan. These who hold to the unity of the book generally date into completion between 500 and 470 BC. Zechariah began his prophetic ministry in the second year of the Persian king Darius in 522-486 BC. And his last detailed prophecy was delivered 2 years later in 518 BC. Zechariah lived and prophesied during the period following the Babylonian captivity in 597-538 BC. Jeremiah had predicted that the Israelites would return to the promised land after 70 years of discipline in exile. God began fulfilling his promise when he raised up Cyrus, king of Persia, whose military exploits brought about the capture of Judah were among who benefited from the reversal of Babylonian policy. The first group of Jews returned under the leadership of Sheshbazzar in Ezra 1, chapter 1, verses 8, in 537 BC. The altar for the group, for the temple, was resulted in the abandonment of the work until 520 BC. During these 16 years of neglect, the people of Judah lost their vision and the sense of spiritual purpose. Their procrastination resulted in divine chastening in Haggai chapter 1 verses 11 and chapter 2 verses 17. Although the crops failed and the people languished, they did not repent until God raised up two prophets to turn the people back to himself. In 520 BC, Haggai called for the Israelites to recognize their spiritual priorities and rebuild the temple. Zechariah began his prophetic ministry just 2 months after Haggai. Compare chapter 1, verses 1. The ministries of Haggai and Zechariah did not cease when work began in earnest on the temple. The prophet continued to encourage the people. Haggai's message were delivered in 520 BC. Zechariah's last dated prophecy was given in 518 BC, see chapter 7, verses 1, with the people committed to restoring the worship of the Lord and of the temple. God poured out his blessings on a repentant and spiritually revitalized people. The temple was completed in 515 BC and rededicated with great rejoicing. Zechariah prophecies had two purposes. First, they challenged the returning exiles to turn to the Lord, to be cleansed. Zechariah's word comforted and encouraged. 15. In the first chapter, Zechariah encouraged the people by focusing on God's choice of Jerusalem. Chapter 1, verses 17, Jerusalem reaffirmed Jerusalem's divine election, but promoted among his returning people and live in their midst. See chapter 2, verses 10 and 11, chapter 8, verses 3 and 23. It was through his personal presence among his people that God would accomplish a miraculous work. The second half of the book, Zechariah details God's future dealings with his chosen people, revealing the overthrow of Israel's enemies, the future glory of Zion, and the universal reign of the Messiah. This is the overarching theme of the book. The complete restoration of God's people would occur in the redeeming and delivering work of the coming Messiah. Zechariah teaches a great deal concerning the first and second coming of Jesus, the Messiah. He refers to the Messiah as the branch in chapter 3, verses 8. God's servant in chapter 3, 8, and God's shepherd in chapter 13, verses 7. There is also an allusion to the Messiah's mystery as a priest king in chapter 6, verses 13. You can see Hebrews 6, 20 through to chapter 7, verses 1. Furthermore, He prophesied the Messiah entrance into Jerusalem on a colt in chapter 9, verses 9. You see Matthew 21, verses 4 and 5. John 12, 14 through 16. His betrayal for 30 pieces of silver can be found in chapter 11, verses 12 and chapter 13. You can see Matthew 27, verses 9 and 10. The piercing of his hands and feet found in 12:10 and of Zechariah as the most quoted section of the prophet in the narratives of the gospel. Concerning the Messiah's second coming, Zechariah prophesied such future events as the conversion of Israel. In chapter 12, verses 10 through 30, through chapter 13, verses 1 through 9. You can see Romans 11, 26. The destruction of Israel's enemies is found in chapter 14, verses 3 and chapter and verses 12 through 15. Along with his emphasis on the Messiah, Zechariah appropriately gives an important message about God's plan for salvation, the importance of repentance and returning to the Lord of hosts is emphasized in the introduction in chapter 1, verses 3 through 6. And then in chapter 3, verses 1 through 5, Zechariah provides a striking illustration of the removal of sin and the imputation of righteousness. The removal of the high priest's filthy garment and the provision of clean festal robes illustrates the work of Christ. Through his atoning death, Christ strips us of our filthy sins and clothes us with his own righteousness. In this way, we can approach our holy God. True religion, according to Zechariah, is not found merely in external facts of religious piety, but is based upon a personal relationship with God. In chapter 7, verses 1 through chapter 7, verses 5 through 7. Such a relationship with God should change one's attitude to one's neighbors like their prophet before him. Zechariah condemned the apprehension of the widow, the orphan, and the stranger and the poor. Chapter 7, verses 10. As a preacher of righteousness, he calls God's people back to the virtues of justice, kindness, compassion, and truth. Right? Not to, underline the word truth. Chapter 7, verses 9, and chapter 8, verses 16. That's bringing us to the end of the introduction of the book of Zechariah. All right? We now take a look at continuing a lesson. A lesson for, the reason why the church think women, why some church think that women should rule in the church. All right? Now let's take a close look to some Bible texts that they use to support that. 1 Corinthians 14, 23 through 25. That says, it says basically, if all prophesy and there come in one that believe not, or one unlearned, he is convinced of all, he is judged of all. What they're trying to say is that the word, the operative word is all. They're trying to say that because in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 23 to 25, Paul was writing about the speaking in tongues and all of that. And if people come in and all y'all are prophesying rightly, then the person will be convinced. And it doesn't have anything to do, right, with a woman having authority in the church, right? Now these are scriptures that you're going to hear people who support that kind of thing coming up with, right? And that whole entire chapter had to do with speaking in tongues, right? How you conduct yourself and prophesying, it's not the same as being an authoritative figure, leading or teaching or usurping over men. 1 Corinthians 11:5 talks about a woman prophesying with her head uncovered, right? They would use that, right? So that a woman, the word here is prophesying. A woman prophesies or is prophesying, right? It is saying that a woman that should not prophesy. A prophet, you know, the Bible never say that a woman cannot prophesy. Or a woman cannot, if she have a word, from God, that she can say it, but it must be done in order. And it's, and when she get up and make her delivery, she deliver to the congregation, as they permit her, then she sit down back, right? Saying, well, God has said so-and-so is going to happen, that's it. But not having authority, not being a bishop, or not teaching, right? Nothing to do with teaching in that chapter, right? In that verse. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, 26 talks about order. If everyone has something to say, it has to be done in order. So the word here that they use is everyone, right? The word that they want to use here to say that a woman have rights to teach in the church is when it says everyone, right? It simply says that everything must be done in order. Everybody come in and everybody have something. Some have a prophecy. Some have some, everybody got something. Not everybody getting up and doing things. God is a God of order, right?
has you thinking about swapping your desk chair for a lounge?
Now let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? The word here, they're using the Spirit, your body, being a temple, right? And the Spirit of God dwelling therein, right? So if our body is a temple and God is indwelling us all, then it means that, you know, because God indwell you, if you think you should be teaching or preaching or, you know, being a pastor as a female, then so let it be. Totally out of context. That does not say anything about a woman leading or teaching. Now let's look at Matthew 28 verses 19, right? They use that, Matthew 28, 19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, in the name of the Father. I'm not going to say of the Son of the Holy Ghost, because in the name of the Father covers it. Again, they would use, everybody was asked to go ye therefore and preach and to teach. Now, the Bible never stopped, right? I showed you last week, Priscilla and Aquila, right? As they, you know, they taught the young Apollo and so on aside. The Bible never said that a woman cannot teach, right? Or cannot prophesy. But the leadership in the church, right? Nowhere in the it says that she can teach or hold office in, such office in the church as pastor or elder. And one could even argue that he was speaking to men, right? According to verse 16 of Matthew 28, right? Because in verse 16, when he rose from the dead, you know, and then it says that the 11 disciples met him, right? They met him on the mountain, and that's where he taught them. And that's where that little after that, that was said, go ye therefore into all the world. Earlier, right, we see in Matthew 5 verses 7, they would use this. The angel told the women to go and tell others, right? The word is that they'll say the angel telling the women to go and tell others. That's not God saying, you know, go and be authoritative or hold position or be a pastor or be an elder or teach the men. Nothing of the sort, right? Now, Titus 2:3-5. Let the older women teach the younger women to be sober, to love their husbands, and to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, right? The word, right? It says, so that the word of God be not blasphemed, right? So if the woman is going to do anything contrary to this, there's a good chance that the word of God could be blasphemed. And because of that, women doing contrary to what God is saying here, the word of God is being blasphemed. You know, it says, you see here, it never said that a woman can't teach, right? You have in churches where you have the women's ministry, where the women meet, and it's supposed to be, you know, the women teaching the younger women how to conduct themselves, since they are now going into relationship, you know, marriage and so on, how to love your husband, how to care for your husband, how to do this. So, you know, for the most part these days, you know, it's it's not done that way. You know, I think when you have like women ministry and that kind of thing, it should be okay, the women teaching women to cook, women to care, so that they can have, you know, they can be better, you know, mothers, mothers of the church, mothers at home, because you might not be a mother, right? But, you know, it says, let the older women, you know, be like mothers to the younger. So they're teaching, you know. Women played an important, very important role in the church, but was never given authority over men. In those previous verses, it was Titus who was charged with teaching. This word was given to Titus as to what to do, how to teach the women about the conducting of themselves, how they conduct themselves. Right, so again, it was a man who was given that thing. These doctrines to the church, there was women prophets. There was a lot of women in the Bible who prophesied, but not given charge over the congregation from Genesis to Revelation. You wouldn't find that. You had women prophets, again, right? You had women, people use the thing to show that Anna was in the temple and how she spent days in the temple praying. It has nothing to do with having authority over men. So all those texts and those, you know, those Bible verses is new, you know, you know, for this situation. You know, you can't say that they was, you know, to be given authority over men. You know, no part of it. And then you also have other verses that is gonna, you can read, that will help you understand that. And I challenge anybody who think that there is, they come across a scripture that strongly support that, you know, then you let me know. Write it in the comments and let me know, you know, where you found it, and so on and so forth. But you have 2 Kings, they'll use 2 Kings chapter 22, 11 through 20. 2 Chronicles 34, they'll use that, 34, 13 through 35. Isaiah chapter 8, verses 3. Nehemiah chapter 6, 14, use Luke 2, 36 to 38, Acts chapter 2, verses 17 through 18, and chapter 21 through 8 through 9, to say that women are, you know, supposed, you know, women can say, you know, and to teach in the church and have authority. So you guys read that for yourself and see if the Bible says anything like that, if that is what it means. And if you think that is what it means, you know, you go, when you go, you know, you write it in the comments, you can, when you go to the YouTube channel, you know, you can make your comments there as it relates to what you think women's role in the church is. However, next week, we'll be looking at what the true meaning of Babylon in chapter 14 of Revelation, when it says, come out of Babylon, my people, come out of her, what that means, right? And sometimes we, you know, those of us who want to do what we want to do, we say it means this, right? We don't include what we're doing. You know, we said it means this or it means that. You know, we'll try to look at what's the meaning of Babylon, you know, physical Babylon and spiritual Babylon, and what that means, you know. And then we'll see all of these coming together. Why, you know, these are very important topics to deal with, you know, when you understand what really is Babylon, You know, my thing about women, in the church is like this. You have a home where there is a father and a mother, and you have children. The father there is the authority. The female in the house, which is the wife, she play a supportive role, right? And sometimes they preach so much about this, you know, the neck can't, the head can't move without the neck, and put it in some context that cause people to support, a matter of fact, to support the erroneous doctrine that women can teach. But in the Bible, you know, the ideal family is you have God is the come force in the family. You have the male as the priest of the home. You have the female playing the main supportive role. And the children who all are being taught, right, by the priest in the home who is supposed to set a good example. But the female teaches as well. She teach the children. She's supposed to be doing that. That's her role, you know, in the home, as to enforcing the teachings of the priest, who will, you know, if he's a true priest of God, you know, lead in accordance of God's plan for that for a family, you know. So she's reinforcing that, you know, bringing the children up in the way of the Lord. In the church, right, it's a family. You have a family in the church, and you have the men there who are supposed to be acting, you know, like priests, right? And why I use the word like a priest, because there's no more priest. Jesus is the ultimate priest and high priest of the church. So if they're going to take guidance from the Almighty and through his word, they pass it down to the congregation, the women in the church there is going to be supportive of that. They're playing a very important role as well, right? So because of what they were taught, they now can teach the younger women about how to conduct themselves, how to be humble, how to be submissive, how to lead a godly life, so that when they get their family, they would know how, and if they have already, then they will know how to conduct themselves with their family. But some may ask, what if a woman have a gift to teach? You know, forget about what gift you have. It is supposed to be done in order. You know, you have a gift to teach. You have children. You have children in the church. You have children at home. You have younger women. You know, you have women like yourself who do not know. You know, and there might be a man who might come to you and ask you to show him because he do not know. You know, hey. But in church, it's a difference. So in the congregation, that's what it says. I do not permit a woman to teach or to usurp authority over the man, right? And he go on to mention why, you know, the reason why. So there's no text showing that, you know, thing. So, but the thing is, because the church has moved so far away from where God want them to be, anything now counts. Anything, right, is everything in the church, you know. Men teaching erroneous doctrine, women teaching erroneous, men putting women to lead while they sit down and don't want to, you know, play the role that God ordained them to play, you know. So let the woman go, let the woman, you know, do her thing, and then you turn around and make it law, you know, and say that, you know, gospel saying that this is the way it's supposed to be, just because somebody's lazy or somebody don't want, you know, have anything to do with God, so you just like, you know, shirky responsibility. But this is how the Bible ordained it to be, right? Amos 5:10 says, those who detest the one who tells the truth speak about those who detest and the one who speaks the truth. So if you speak the truth, you'll be detested. Somebody got to do it anyhow, right? And I choose to teach the truth. We're going to speak the truth, right, as it relates to the Word of God, right? And 2 Timothy 2:25, you know, when it says when you repent, right, it leads you to a knowledge of truth. In order to receive the truth, you got to repent. Repent, right, and He's going to lead us to a knowledge of truth. You can't get the truth if you don't repent. So there's other people coming along, going along with the old doctrine, the parents, grandparents, this is how it was, you know, and this is how they grew up knowing it, and they continue, we continue, you know, because I was one, you know, I used to keep Forest Day, and I grew up keeping Forest Day and get to know the truth. And you got to live according to the truth, you know, turn from that. You have Galatians chapter 4, 16, right? It says that you'll be an enemy for telling the truth. So if you don't want to, if you don't want enemies, you ain't going to tell the truth. If you want a sweet skin, the way to keep a sweet skin is to stay away from the truth of God. But if you tell the truth, people are going to hate you, right? They ain't going to like that. Like I always said, people is this kind of teaching ain't going to attract much people because this is not what people want. You know, people don't want the truth. People want to hear things that would make them, motivate them in the wrong direction. You know, you want to go in the direction you want to go, then you heap up teachers to teach you what your itching ears want to hear, and in a way that you want them to tell it, you know. Jump up, make a lot of nice whoop and holler, and build up that momentum and get the feelings going so that the devil could work in you to his goodwill and pleasure. But the truth come naked, you know. The truth don't need no covering. So when you unveil the truth, it don't look very pretty for some people, you know. So it's who choose you this day whom you're going to serve, you know. If you're going to serve God, then serve God. You know, ain't got no middle ground. If you're going to serve the devil, right? But don't say God say what God didn't say, right? So God says in my conclusion, right, to Paul, let your women remain silent in church. I suffer not a woman to teach or to preach, you know, to teach or to usurp authority. So therefore, if you, you know, are dating a woman and you're calling her a pastor or a bishop, you're setting her up for leadership. And if she's a leader, then she has the final say. Who she'll be having it over? Men. Right? And next week, we're going to understand Babylon. Remember these? And so that you can be able to understand more about Babylon and what the Bible means when it says, come out of her, my people. Come out. All right? So thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you for your support. And share the video if you so choose. And like, and, you know, so that this gospel may be preaching to all the world, for every nation, kindred and tongue, that everybody may be able to hear. And then Jesus is going to be able to hasten his coming, because he want to make sure that everybody hears. So that nobody would have an excuse, right, when he comes the second time, you know. And, you know, hellfire and brimstone started raining, nobody would be able to say, I didn't know. And those of us who had a chance to tell somebody but choose not to tell, you understand me? And if that soul is being lost, then you'll be alongside them in hell, you know, because it is our duty, you know, he said, when you have become strong, you know, strengthen your brother. You know, and if after years of serving, you ain't strong, something is wrong with you. You ain't doing the right thing, or you have not yet repented. For when you repent, right, according to 2 Timothy chapter 2:25, then a wealth of knowledge, right, is going to lead you to a knowledge of truth, to the knowledge of truth. And then when he leads you to the knowledge of truth, he's going to give you boldness in order to stand for the truth, even though the heavens fall. You know, be like me. I learned the truth of the word before, long years now. And it's only now I decide to, you know, I had the pluck to come forward with the truth, right? And there's no stopping and there's no holding back, right? And if I gotta be alone here, you know, every week, I'm gonna do it and know for sure that I'm doing my part and feel good to know that I have, you know, done what God asked me to do and look for the next opportunity to spread the word, right? All right, so thank you. May God bless you all and keep you. Until next time, you know, take care and read your Bible and pray every day, and so that God may be able to reveal himself to you. You know, he's going to reveal himself to everyone who asks him to do so. So do that, and so that we'll be able to stand on the day of judgment. All right? And not beating up on your pastor, your elder, your leader, whoever, and saying, you were the one who have me here. No, you have yourself there. All right, take care. God bless. Until next time. Love you all.